Hello everyone and welcome to a new video on my channel. In this video, I am going to discuss about network address translation, or in short form, this is also called as NAT. And please do also watch my other videos on computer networking. I have uploaded a lot of videos on computer networking and those will be there in a playlist on my channel. And you can find the link to that playlist in the comment section as well as description of this video. So let's first try to understand the difference between private IP address and public IP address before moving to NAT, because this is very important. Public IP addresses can be accessed from the internet, whereas you cannot access a private IP address. This is very, very important. So public IP addresses are public in nature, okay? And you can access those, like, I mean, whenever a machine is having a public IP address, you can access that basically. So you can run ping command and provide that public IP address, and you should be able to ping that machine. But in case of private IP address, that's not possible. Of course, it is possible within your network. So if you have a LAN here, and like if you have, I mean, two or three devices there, of course you can ping this, private IP address within the network. But let's say there is another network here, and this again has a private IP address. You cannot directly ping this, like from here to here, you cannot ping this, device here. You cannot do that because both are having private IP address. So typically you will have routers in between. So within this LAN, you will have one router. Within this LAN, you will have one or more than one routers. And these routers typically will have public IP address, which will help in communicating between these two different LAN. So some of the examples of public IP address are, for example, www.google.com. So www.google.com is a public website. So it has a public IP address it has multiple IP address. One of the public IP addresses, for example, 142.250.71.4. Another public IP address is 8.8.8.8. So this is the IP address of the Google DNS server. Private IP addresses are allocated to device within a LAN. So if you check your IP address, typically your IP address will be a private IP address. And the IP address of your router, in most cases, will be a public IP address. So now let's see some of the examples of private IP address. Like these three subnets are popular examples of private subnets. So first one is 10.0.0.0/8. That is IP address from 10.0.0.0 to 10.255.255.255. So if you see any IP address within this range, typically those are private IP address. Similarly, there are other two examples are also mentioned here. So you can check your IP address. Typically your IP address should fall within any of these three private subnets. Another popular one is the 172.16.0.0/12 subnet. Another one is 192.168.0.0/16 subnet. These three are popular examples of private IP addresses. Now let's try to understand what is NAT. So NAT stands for Network Address Translation. It's a method of mapping an IP address to another IP address. So mapping one IP address to another IP address by changing the IP packet. So we will understand this better when we actually look at how NAT works, then we'll understand this concept better. So in NAT, what happens? Multiple IP addresses are mapped to a single public IP address. Again, we will see later how this happens. So the next question is, why do we need NAT? Right? What is the need for having a network address translation? Total number of internet devices that we have in the world right now is around 20 billion, and it's growing very fast. But total number of IPv address which we have, the maximum number of IPv4 address that we can have is just 4 billion, right? So for this 20 billion internet devices, I mean, we have only 4 billion IP address, IPv4 address. So we cannot assign a single IP address to all these 20 billion devices. It's not possible since we have less number of IPv4 addresses and more number of internet devices. So we cannot have a 1:1 mapping for each of these 20 billion internet devices. So that's why not possible to assign a unique IPv4 address to each device. So this is the reason why NAT is needed. And when we see how NAT works, then you'll understand like how, and now when we look at how NAT works, you will be able to see right how NAT helps in addressing this issue. Let's try to understand how NAT works. This concept is very, very important, like how the NAT actually works. So here we have a local area network. So you can see this local area network here, and there are three devices here. One is having the IP address 10.0.0.1. And as we saw in public versus a private IP address, this is a private IP address. All these three are private IP address. Another one is 10.0.0.2. Another one is 10.0.0.3. Okay, these are the three devices that we have in this LAN. And of course, you have a router here, which is associated with this LAN. And this router has two interfaces. One is a private network interface, that is 10.0.0.4. Another one is a public network interface, that is having the IP address 138.26.29.7. Okay, and if you see, this LAN is basically connected to this private network interface, and then you have the public network, that is exposed, right? Like if any of these devices wants to communicate with the external world, basically, like maybe another LAN, for example, right? They will use the public IP address for this communication. Let's now try to understand what actually happens when one of these devices wants to communicate with a server which is outside this LAN, not within this LAN, it is outside the LAN. So let's say in another local area network, the server is there in this network, let's say this network here. This is a router associated with that network. And let's say the IP address of this server, this is a public, let's say this is a public facing server, which has a public IP address of 128.119.40.186. And on port number 80 of this public server, I mean a HTTP website is running. And now let's say this machine here that is having the private IP address 10.0.0.1 wants to make a HTTP request to this server running on port number 80. So how it will be done with the help of NAT? Because of course this is having a private IP address, right? And we know that private IP address cannot be accessed, right? So what will typically happen is, so if you remember the HTTP request and response cycle, right? So of course what will happen, first this will send a HTTP request to this server, right? HTTP request, you said HTTP request to this server, okay? And after that, once this server has got the request, it will process that request and reply back, okay, with the response. It will reply back with the response, okay? HTTP response. But the issue here is that this machine here has a private IP address, right? 10.0.0.1. So this server directly cannot communicate with this private IP address because private IP address cannot be accessed. So this HTTP response will not be possible if this machine is having a private IP address. So let's see with the help of NAT how this communication is made possible. So now first what will happen, of course, this wants to make a HTTP request. So of course you will have, I mean, a packet will be formed, which will have typically four layers. We will have application layer, then you will have transport layer, right? Then you will have a network layer, and then you have data link layer. So this will flow from here to the router first. And of course, in application layer, you will have the HTTP request. Then in the transport layer, you will have the port number. So let's say the client is using port number 3345 for communication. And destination port we know, that is 80. Now in the network, what will happen? Of course, first, I mean, you will have a source and destination. So destination address will of course be that of the server, that is 128.119.40.186, and source IP address of course will be of this machine 10.0.0.1, and data link layer will have the MAC address. Okay, but in this but in the discussion of NAT, we will only cover this network layer, like we'll only cover the IP address part. We are not going to cover transport layer and other parts. So that's why you see the four steps mentioned here. You only see the source and destination address mentioned in that, because if you see the flow of first packet, so the first packet is this one, and this flows to the router, and you can see the source address is 10.0.0.1 here, port number is 3345, destination IP address is 128.119.40.186, and destination port number is 80. That's all right. Now this goes to the router. Now this router knows that the source IP address is 10.0.0.1, which is a private IP address, and this router knows that, okay, if I forward this packet to the next router, then what will happen during the round trip, right? When the server has to send the reply, it will not be able to send a reply if I send this packet directly, because source IP address is a private IP address. That's why it will change the source IP address. And that's where the NAT comes into picture. So before sending this packet into the public network, what it will do is it will change the source IP address. If you see in the second packet, the source IP address has been changed to a public IP address. That is the public IP address of the router, 138.76.29.7, okay? And port number has also been changed to 5001. And this mapping is stored in a NAT translation table. If you can see here, this is a NAT translation table that is stored within the router itself. And here you have a mapping on WAN side and LAN side. So of course, LAN side is the mapping of your private IP address, and WAN side is the mapping of the IP address of the router. And the router will also select a random port which has not been used in this table till now. So let's say 5001, and it will map this to the LAN side of like what was there in the LAN, right? So of course it has changed the source IP address, right? But let's say when the reply will come, it has to remember, right, to which device on the LAN side it should send the reply, right? The router should remember that. For that, it will also store the mapping on the LAN side, right? 10.0.0.1 and port number 3345. Now, of course, this packet will flow to the server. So this will go to the server. Server will process this HTTP request. Of course, I have not included other headers here, like application layer, transport layer, all of this. All of this will be there. This server will process the request and it will reply back. Of course, now the source IP address will be that of this server and port number 80. And destination IP address will be reverse of this, right? What was there in the second packet, that will reverse of that. So now destination will be the 138.76.29.7 and port number 5001. And of course, we know that this is the destination IP address is that of the router. Now this third packet, let's say, has been received by this router. Now, but the router has to now differentiate, right? To which of these three hosts should it send this, this packet. Now, what it will do, it will check for the mapping, okay? It will check for that, okay? Destination is 138.76.29.7, port number 5001. It will see in that translation table, okay, for this mapping, destination and port number, what we have here, like which one is the equivalent device there, right? So it will see that on the LAN side, this is mapped to 10.0.0.1.3345. Now, if you see the fourth packet, you can see source still remains the, this server IP address and 80 port number. Destination has been changed by the router. It has changed destination to 10.0.0.1.3345 port number. So now it can correctly send this to this machine here, because this is the IP address 10.0.0.1. And how this has been made possible, right? How this conversion from like public IP address to private IP address, how this has been made possible? That has been made possible with the help of NAT translation table. You can see the power of NAT here. So basically you can have a lot of machines here, right? A lot of devices here in this LAN network, and all of these can have private IP addresses. And all these, machines or devices can use a single public IP address, that is the public IP address of a router, for communicating with the outside world, right? Similarly, you can have another LAN, right? A lot of LAN here, right? A lot of LAN will be here. And all of these can have same IP address, like machines here, again, in this LAN also, can have like IP address like 10.0.0.1. It is possible. So with private IP address, it's possible that this machine here, okay, and this machine here, like both can have the same private IP address. It's possible. Two machines in different LANs can have the same private IP address. But having same public IP address is not possible. Only one machine can have, unique public IP address. So that's why even if you have 20 billion devices, right? So they can share the same private IP address, right? And then you can have a router outside all of this LAN, okay? You can have a router outside this LAN, which can have a different public IP address. And this public IP address will be unique to each router. Devices that you have inside this LAN, they can share the private IP address. Share the private IP address means that, like this machine here can have the same private IP address. Now, of course, two machines within the network cannot have same private IP address, right? And of course, now we have seen the advantage of NAT, but there are also some drawbacks of NAT. So let's try to understand that. So first is that port numbers are meant for addressing processes and not hosts. So what we are doing here is that we are using port numbers, you see, in the NAT table, right? Translation table. We are using port numbers for mapping host, right? So you can easily see the example here, right? For this host, that is 10.0.0.1, we have used a combination of port also here, right? For mapping it. But if you remember, what is the use of port numbers, right? Port numbers are typically used for addressing a process, right? Not for mapping host. Also, routers should process packets till network layer. So the main use of routers is to process the packets only till network layer. But of course, we know that what we are doing here, right? We are also using the port numbers, right? This router is also checking the port number, right? What is the source port number, right? What is the destination port number, right? It's also checking that. And another one is that, like, instead of NAT, why don't we use IPv6 address, right? Because IPv6 address, if you remember, we can have 2^128 unique public IP address, right? We can have this much of IP address with the help of IPv6 address. And of course, this should be able to address all the devices that we have. And also, it should be able to cater to the demand in the future. So why not use IPv6 address if you are running out of IPv4 address rather than using NAT, like which has some serious drawbacks in the network, right? On the network part, right? It uses port numbers for different purposes. Routers also are processing information till transport layer, right? Which is, so these are some of the serious drawbacks of NAT. But of course, there are advantages also. And in case we move to IPv6 address in the future, in that case, the use of NAT will decrease. But of course, that's not happening any soon now. With the help of this NAT transmission table, the router is able to make sure that, okay, it forwards the packet to the right host on this LAN, right? And also, please do not forget to subscribe to my channel and also like this video. Thank you.